In this video, we shall study the climate of India. When it comes to the word climate, it refers to the sum total of weather conditions and variations over a large area for a long period of time. That is for more than 30 years. So, if I study the weather conditions of India for a period of more than 30 years, we come to a conclusion that the climate of India is monsoon type. Okay. If this is the definition of climate, what is weather? Weather refers to the state of the atmosphere over an area at any point of time. That means, say, if it is raining, I will say it is a rainy day and the weather is rainy. If it is very cool outside, I will say the weather is cool. Now, these two words, that is climate and weather, they are made up of the same elements, that is temperature, atmospheric pressure, wind, humidity and precipitation. Now, you may have observed that the weather conditions fluctuate very often within a day. On the basis of generalized monthly atmospheric conditions, the year is divided into seasons such as winter, summer and the rainy season. When it comes to India, the climate of India is described as the monsoon type. Now, this type of climate is found mainly in the south and Southeast Asia. The word monsoon comes from the word mausam, and it refers to the winds which change their direction. Again, in India, the winds blow from southwest to northeast and northeast to southwest. We shall study in detail a little later as to why these winds blow in these directions. Now, if I take India, India has monsoon type of climate. Now, in spite of an overall unity in the general pattern, there are clear regional variations that can be seen in climatic conditions within the country. Let us take two important elements, that is temperature and precipitation, and examine how they vary from place to place and season to season. If I take temperature, Barmer in Rajasthan may record a temperature of 48 degrees Celsius to 50 degrees Celsius on a June day, while it hardly reaches 22 degrees Celsius at Pahalgam or Gulmarg in Kashmir on the same day. However, in Dras near Kargil, the temperature may go down to minus 40 degrees Celsius during winter. Kerala has tropical climate with warm and moist air, whereas Punjab has continental climate with severe heat alternating with severe cold. The temperature touches minus 40 degrees Celsius in Kargil in the month of December, whereas Kerala records 20 degrees Celsius to 22 degrees Celsius in the same month. The annual range of temperature is 3 degrees Celsius along the Malabar coast. The annual range of temperature means the difference between the hottest and the coldest month. So this difference is just 3 degrees along the Malabar coast. The reason is moderating influence of the sea. Whereas it is more than 20 degrees Celsius in the interiors. The reason is it is away from the sea. So the difference between day and night temperature in the Andaman and Nicobar Islands and Kerala is hardly 7 or 8 degrees Celsius. Whereas in the Thar Desert, it is between 25 to 30 degrees Celsius. It means if the day temperature is 50 degrees Celsius, the night temperature would drop down to 20 to 25 degrees Celsius. Next one is precipitation. Variations occur not only in the type of precipitation, but also in the amount and the seasonal distribution. Snowfall occurs in the Himalayas, whereas it only rains over the rest of the country. Chirapunji and Mausanram in Meghalaya gets about 1100 centimeters rains in the year, whereas Jaisalmer in Rajasthan hardly receives 9 centimeters of rainfall in a year. Tura in Meghalaya gets an amount of rainfall in a single day which is equal to 10 years of rainfall at Jaisalmer in Rajasthan. The Coromandel coast remains dry in the month of July and August, whereas the Ganga Delta and the coastal plains of Odisha are hit by strong storms almost every third or fifth day during these months. Most parts of India receive rainfall during June to September, but coastal areas of Tamil Nadu gets rain in the beginning of winter season. These are the regional variations in terms of precipitation. So, let us study the factors that control the climate of any place. There are six major controls of the climate of any place, and they are latitude, altitude, pressure and wind system, distance from the sea, ocean currents, and relief features. If we take up the first factor, latitude. Now, the earth is spherical in shape. Due to the curvature of the earth, the amount of solar energy received varies according to latitude. If equator is receiving vertical rays of the sun, gradually if you are moving towards the poles, the rays become slanting. So, the air temperature decreases from the equator towards the poles. Coming to India, the Tropic of Cancer passes through the middle of the country. That is from Run of Kutch in the west to Mizoram in the east. Almost half of the country lie to the south of Tropic of Cancer belongs to tropical area. Whereas the remaining area, which is in the north, lies in the subtropical area. Therefore, India's climate has characteristics of tropical as well as subtropical climates. The second factor is altitude. Now, you must know that there is a decrease of 1 degree for every 166 meters rise in height. This is because as one goes from the surface of the earth to higher altitudes, the atmosphere becomes less dense and the temperature decreases. The hills are therefore cooler during summers. Now, India is covered by different landforms. That is, India has mountains, plateaus, and plains. So, it results in difference in temperature. If I take up Himalayas, Himalayas have an average height of about 6,000 meters. On the other hand, if I take up coastal plains, the maximum elevation is about 30 meters. The Himalayas prevent the cold winds from Central Asia from entering the subcontinent. It is because of these mountains that this subcontinent experiences comparatively milder winters as compared to Central Asia. The coastal plains, on the other hand, creates a moderating influence on the climate. This is because of the sea breeze and the land breeze. Next one is the pressure and the wind systems. We will study this under three categories, that is pressure and surface winds, then upper air circulation and western cyclonic disturbances and tropical cyclones. Based on the rotation and revolution of the earth and the apparent movement of the sun, different pressure belts have developed on the earth and the surface winds move from high pressure areas to low pressure areas. Some of the important wind on the earth are easterlies, westerlies, polar winds, and the monsoon winds. And two different type of winds blow over India, that is southwest and northeast monsoon winds. The southwest monsoon winds blow from sea to land, that is they are onshore winds. And northeast winds blow from land to sea, that is they are called offshore winds. Why do these winds deflect? Actually, these winds deflect to the right in the northern hemisphere and they deflect to the left in the southern hemisphere. The reason behind that is Coriolis force. Now, what is Coriolis force? It is an apparent force caused by the earth's rotation. The earth rotates from west to east at a speed of 1600 kilometers per hour. The Coriolis force is responsible for deflecting winds towards the right in the northern hemisphere and towards left in the southern hemisphere. This is also known as the Ferrell's law. The pressure and wind conditions over India are unique. During winter, there is a high pressure area north of the Himalayas. Cold, dry winds blow from these regions to the low pressure area over the oceans to the south. In summer, a low pressure area develops over the interior Asia as well as over northwest India. This causes a complete reversal of the direction of winds during summer. The air moves from the high pressure area over the southern Indian Ocean in a southeasterly direction, crossing the equator, and turns right towards the low pressure area over the Indian subcontinent. Now, these are known as southwest monsoon winds, and these winds blow over the warm oceans, gathering moisture and bringing widespread rainfall over the mainland of India. The upper air circulation in this region is dominated by the westerly flow. An important component of this flow is the jet streams. When I say jet stream, it refers to winds that blow at a great speed. Now, these jet streams are located approximately over 27 to 30 degrees north and south latitude, and therefore they are known as subtropical westerly jet streams. Over India, these jet streams blow south of Himalayas all through the year except summer. Then the western cyclonic disturbances. Now, these are experienced in the north and the northwestern part of the country, and they are brought down by the westerly flow. In summer, the subtropical westerly jet streams move north of Himalayas with the apparent movement of the sun. An easterly jet stream called the tropical easterly jet stream blow over peninsular India. This is approximately over 14 degree north during summer months. Now, the western disturbances are weather phenomena brought in by westerly flow from the Mediterranean region. They occur in the month of winter and cause rainfall in north and northwestern part of India. The moisture in these storms usually originate over the Mediterranean Sea and the Atlantic Ocean, and they travel towards east. Although the amount of rainfall is meager, it is highly beneficial to rabi crops, especially the wheat. Now, the same winds cause snowfall in the mountains. The next factor is the distance from the sea. Now, the sea exerts a moderating influence on climate. Let us understand how. During the daytime, both the land and the sea gets heated. The land gets heated more than the sea. So at land, the temperature is high and the pressure is low. And the water bodies, the temperature is relatively low and pressure is high. So the wind starts blowing from sea towards land, and this is known as sea breeze. So during the daytime, the coastal areas will receive sea breeze. But at the night time, the land gets cooler than the sea. So at the land, the temperature is low and the pressure is high. So wind starts blowing from land towards sea. So during night time, what we have is land breeze. Because of the land breeze and sea breeze, a moderating climate is developed. As the distance from the sea increases, the moderating influence of the sea also decreases, and the people experience extreme weather conditions. This is known as continentality. That is, it would be very hot during summer and very cold during winters. It would be very hot during day and cold during winter. Next factor is the ocean currents. Ocean currents are large masses of surface water that circulate in regular patterns around the ocean. The warm currents move from equator towards the poles, and the cold currents move from the poles towards the equator. For example, any coastal area with warm or cold currents flowing past it will be warmed or cooled if the winds are onshore. Examples of cold currents are Labrador Current, Peruvian Current, Benguela Current. Whereas examples of warm currents are Brazilian Current, North Atlantic drift. Then comes the relief. The word relief means variation in height. Now the relief too plays a major role in determining the climate of a place, because if it is a mountainous area, it means the relief is high. But if it is a plateau or a plain, the relief is relatively low. Now high mountains act as a barriers for cold and hot winds. They may also cause precipitation if they are high enough to lie in the path of rain-bearing winds. On the other hand, the leeward side of the mountains remains dry. The Western Ghats obstructs the southwest monsoon winds, and they are responsible for heavy rainfall along the western coast, whereas the Deccan Plateau forms the leeward side where there is relatively low rainfall.